Hello and welcome to the week. Today we are joined by Mr. Aditya Vikram Birla. He is the Dynamic Chairman and Managing Director of the Cosmic Birla Group, an emerging conglomerate from the eastern parts of the country. Thank you, Mr. Birla. Thank you for joining the week. Mr. Birla, let's start off with this conglomerate, the Cosmic Birla Group. It has a vast portfolio of companies. If you could give us a sense of, you know, from the beginning, what was the thought process, what was the idea, and how is it growing?
Right. So I'll tell you what. Cosmic Birla Group was initially called Cosmic Group. This entire conglomerate started almost 52 odd years back. We are running for 53rd year right now. This was started by my grandfather, who was working with GD Birla Sahab that time. And he was basically living in his house only in Worli, the Birla house. That is when he kind of thought that, you know, he wants to stop now working in his own, the corporate affairs of Mr. Birla, and he wants to start his own affairs. So he kind of started his first company in the name of Cosmic Engineers in Bengal, which was basically set up. It had set up a small SME unit in a place called Baltigudi, which is like an industrial estate in Bengal. And that used to manufacture small components, almost 10 to 15 odd components for the Indian Railways. That's how the group started. Coming back to Cosmic Birla Group today, we have renamed and rebranded the entire Cosmic Group over the last 2 years in the name of Cosmic Birla Group. Reason being, there's a constant affair, a constant question that happens, whether this group is a Birla Group or not. So we kind of mentioned, okay, fine, this is the Birla Group. There are lots of Birla Groups out there. There are 17 odd Birla Groups, SK Birla Group, CK Birla Group. We would have called this group RS Birla Group. But however, Cosmic being our brand and also our flagship companies have all been called Cosmic. That's why we've named it Cosmic. I per se I'm on the third generation. So my father and my father's brothers, they were all a part of the group at some point. Over the last 3 years, we kind of brought it down into a position where I said, you know, this is how I want to lead the group. So people who probably want to get bought out and, give up the entire strength to me and my core team, which is professionally run, we would like to take it that way. So we kind of renamed the Cosmic Group as Cosmic Birla Group, and this entire legacy of 52 years continues, where we still run the companies that probably had started 52 years back in the name of Comet Technocom and also Cosmic Engineers. And today we have a large bit of companies in the name of Cosmic CRF, and then we have Cosmic Rail Solutions, we have Cosmic Castings and all of these companies. So we have the entire group today runs almost 18 odd companies and 12 factories. The 13th factory is about to open the next month. I think August 10th it should open in Domsur in Howrah, Calcutta, Bengal itself.
Great, Mr. Birla. You have recently forayed into the electric vehicle business with the acquisition of RAF Motors. Give us a sense of what is the idea behind this acquisition and what are your plans as far as the EV business goes?
So, Nachiketji, it is a very funny story around it. Basically, we primarily call ourselves an engineering conglomerate where we are manufacturing more than 3,000 SQs for railways, as well as for defense and as well as for locomotives and you know, the infrastructure companies. So we were primarily in the basis of the idea that, okay, our strength lies in manufacturing of components. I happened to be in Telangana in 2019 and 20, right before COVID, and I came across this entire team of Olectra Greentech, which is today one of the leading companies in the EV sector. And I was in their factory in Cherrapalli, and we were discussing things. However, we came across a couple of components which are being bought out by them from various sources in Faridabad, and also maybe importing those components, where the pricing of those components were very heavy as per my knowledge. So we kind of redid the entire math and we kind of re-engineered the entire project. And we saw that we can produce and manufacture the components that they are using to manufacture the vehicles at almost half the price or maybe lesser than that. That is where my interest started coming into the EV sector. However, I kind of envisaged the idea that if I'm a component player, we can never bring it up to a state where we can call ourselves a large-scale industry, because this is a proxy play after all. So we kind of understood that the end game is obviously the EV. So we kind of came across a lot of other companies which have been really struggling over a period of time. And we kind of realized that, okay, you know, this is what we want to do. So we came across two major companies. One was in Gwalior, which we kind of were in talks with over the last 6 months in 2022 and 23 starting. Okay. And we eventually decided that we don't want to go with them. That was a time when I came across the entire management of RAF Motors. Now, RAF Motors was run by three young entrepreneurs who were running this company over the last 7 odd years. So they were really baffling and, you know, getting struggling around the financial bit and you know getting the right kind of fit for them to get a right investor on board. Once we got in, we came in with an equity percentage of 23%. In the next 6 months, we were talking about 75% of equity holding in the company because they were constantly in need of funds and there were old things that were coming out in the open which had to be addressed for the company to survive, run and then grow in the future. Eventually, today, we stand at 100% equity holding and we've taken over the entire company. Now, when we took over the entire company, we realized that our strength lies in the component manufacturing, where our main strength lies in the east of India, right? So we realized that, okay, why don't we get this entire company, obviously it runs as from the primary base is in Maharashtra, but obviously we get the entire base up also, a part of the base runs from the west, from the east of India, which is Bengal. So we are opening up a new factory, which I was talking about right in the question before that. The new factory is going to open up in Dongjur, which is in West Bengal, in our industrial belt. And this is primarily for manufacturing and assembling the EV bikes. We are right now focusing on EV bikes and scooters. We have 4 scooters, which we've already started selling. We have an order book of almost 125 odd crores from likes of Zomato and Swiggy and Blinkit, and also from retail distributors and dealers. Today, we have a network of more than 162 dealers and almost 72 distributors pan-India, where there are dealers and distributors in Maharashtra, in Nasik, in Dhule. We also have distributors in Satna, and also some of them are in, just not based out of UP, but a couple of them in Chennai, in Bangalore, and a lot of them in the East, in Calcutta and West Bengal.
All right, Mr. Birla. And then you have built a huge conglomerate. Could you give us a sense of what are your motivations in building this conglomerate? Who is your role model?
Right. So I'll tell you what. I mean, my entire goal of making this into a conglomerate and not just a home run family business orientation was because the idea is when you go to that scale, you know, it's like climbing the Mount Everest. So every base has its own pressures and own challenges. The moment you step out of the entire, you know, comfort zone of calling yourself a family business orientation over 50 odd years, you have the legacy, yes, but the investors never take interest. Without the investors taking interest, without the world taking interest in you, without the world knowing about you, there are bankers also who will take interest to a certain categorization. And that only leads you to become a debt-heavy company or a debt-heavy conglomerate. Eventually, we had interests. Over the last 50 years, we had interests in FMCG to a smaller extent. But a large extent, we had a huge essence of investments that were done in land banks. So we were also calling ourselves real estate companies. I kind of bridged the entire thing to a lower sense of funneled conceptualization where we said that we are land bank owners. So we don't build buildings anymore. Like if you search our company down, we have probably 32 odd projects that we've done over the last 50 odd years in Calcutta primarily. But today we don't call ourselves builders. We call ourselves, people who are conglomerate who's interested in the real estate market. Yes, we have land banks. Yes, we are looking for JV partners. They partner up with us. It is their job to build the bank, to build the product and, you know, sell and everything. We are only interested in the ROIs. Point two is the FMCG, where we are dealing with manufacturing of ghee and things like that. Ghee and, you know, homemade chevla and noodles and all of that. It's in the name of Comet Tradecom Private Limited. This was again a company that had started as a homegrown company over the last 4 odd years. And we were doing 2 or 3 odd crores to be starting with. Today, we are doing almost 40 odd crores of top lines. But the entire conglomerate today, when we call ourselves a conglomerate, we are doing approximately a top line of almost 1500 odd crores with a baseline which is very, very healthy. Out of this entire set of conglomerates, on the entire set of 18 companies that we have and 12 factories, we have one of our major flagship companies, which is Cosmic CRF Limited, which basically is one of the listed companies in BSE. And I'm proud to say that it is one of the biggest multi-baggers last year. This was a company that we listed at the Bombay Stock Exchange last year in 2023, June, 30th of June. And we listed this at 245 or 50 rupees. It was listed and today it is trading at 2100 rupees. It's not even been 11 months since then. So that's been a very big ride. We've had such big investors in the name of Ashish Kacholia, one of the big whales of the stock market. And we have such names attached to our company today. We started small, but we are growing at an exponential pace. And along with that, we built our interest in various many other companies. So during this last 1.5-2 years, we've also taken over not just RAF Motors in the EV, but we've also taken over a company called NS Engineering Projects Private Limited, which is one of the large scale players in the manufacturing of cold rolled formed items and sections, and also infrastructural items for the defense, the coach builders, as well as the infra. Infra is its main component. So that's another part of our portfolio that's really growing, and it's something that we're really banking on. Along with that, we have also taken a lot of interest in building wagons for the Indian Railways. Today, per se, we don't have a G105 with the license that we require to manufacture the Indian Railways, the wagons. But we are constantly in search of and in pursuit of buying out already existing unit, or maybe setting up our own shop. That will be probably, hopefully, done by God's grace, touch wood, within the next one odd year. We'll be claiming ourselves to be distinguished and established wagon builder. Along with all this, we also have interest in manufacturing of ferroalloys, commodities, and things like that. In the group, it's there. It's not a part of our primary business anymore. It used to be at one point of time. But today, our primary business stays with manufacturing of components and engineering solutions that we are providing to all people across all boards, be it the infrastructure companies, be it the railways, be it the defense.
All right, Mr. Birla. Could you tell us what is it in you that makes you a good leader?
That's a very tricky question, because that's something that somebody else should answer, not me. But whether I'm a good leader or not is something that my team will answer. Yes, we have grown from a strength of almost 350 laborers and almost, if I'm not wrong, 71 staff members to today almost 450 staff members and almost 2,000 laborers directly, indirect. So this has happened over the last 3 years. 3 years back, I was not leading this entire group. I was a part of the group, like I was as a family member. But today, over the last 3 years, I've been leading this group, and it has grown exponentially. So that makes me feel that yes, I'm doing the right thing by the right people. And I have always believed that if I don't do the right by my team and the people, the human resource is not really valued at, and just the machinery is, then the company doesn't really grow. So it's like a family that we are here. We are a 2,500 people family today. And we envisage ourselves to become a family of almost 10,000 people in the next 1.5 odd years.
How do you define success? What do you think makes a successful entrepreneur?
Nachiketi, this question has two parts to it in my mind. When you asked me this question, I'll answer this in two parts. A successful entrepreneur is basically per se a narrative that we all end up believing, right? So it is like it's something that comes out in the open, and we kind of believe that yes, this guy has done something which we find substantially right and substantially good, and probably good to the investors, good to the products that are being delivered to the vendors or to the final customers. Everybody's happy. It's a great way to go. So yeah, he's a good entrepreneur. But let's look at it in a very different perspective, where I say that okay. Any good entrepreneur has his good cycles and bad cycles, right? So an entrepreneur is not really good. I often say it's the time that really defines the person. It's not the person at large. But yes, your basic principles have to be right, sir. I mean, it is not the money that should drive you. It is a byproduct of the work that you're doing. It is not something that I'm quoting out of a book, but it's something that I've believed in, because I was born with a silver spoon. It's not like it drove me for money. My expenses are in lakhs, but we are talking about thousands of crores. So that tells us that it's not about the fact that we are running after the money. If we are trying to make a difference, and not just make a difference for my customer alone, but also make a difference which drives down and has a trickle-down theory to the fact that it also affects the life of my laborers, my indirect people who are also working with the company on the side. Along with that, it is a happy quotient that comes around. Now, an entrepreneur, when he's successful, the happy quotient is in his life, personal and professional. Along with that, everybody around him. That is when the narrative that you put across in the market is acceptable. And our market is extremely smart. I personally feel, we feel that we are smart, but the market always outsmarts us. And the fact that we have grown so much and people have given us that support, I think that believes and makes me believe that we're doing the right. And the entrepreneur at large should also be following that route itself.
So, Mr. Birla, today we see so many new people who want to become entrepreneurs. We are seeing we are seeing new startups come up every day. What is your message to them what is the message that you would like to pass on to them on being budding entrepreneurs?
See, I'll tell you, Nachiketji, I have been working with startups for over some time now because of my interest in the idea. Young startups, they really build on the product and they really work hard initially. So I was working with this company called Venture Catalyst, which is one of the big startup foundations in India right now. in terms of incubations for startups and providing angel investors. I was one of the angel investors in the HNI quotas, right? So I had taken positions, I still taken positions in almost 7 to 8 companies through them. And along with that, I've done a couple of them through my own understanding, my own team, as well as like they do their own math and they do their own due diligence. Having said that, when I was working with all of these guys over the last, say, 7 to 8 years, when I was, I'm 34, so I'm talking about me starting up in 2026 to 2014, 15, or I started working with the startups. And you know, looking at startups very interestingly. There's two things that I found very interestingly, which needs to be corrected among the entrepreneurs. Once that's corrected, I think they find the right way to go about things. The point is, the reason why people, 90% of the people that I talk to, they start the startup is because they are very, very aggressively, let's say, passionate about their project. It's not that the loopholes that they see, because they are not really exposed to the market, or they don't have that kind of exposure, that kind of experience. So they're extremely, extremely positive about whatever they're doing in the way they're approaching. And they're kind of stubborn also at times. So they don't want to really listen. But then comes the second part, where the passion is overtaken by the need for the money. When the money starts flowing in, if you are passionate and you're successful in your first round, which I call round one or round two of the race, after that, the money starts flowing in, and then comes the integrity. So what happens is, eventually, every entrepreneur should realize and believe that what are you really doing? You're not really, making anything which is not there in the market. Yeah, you can make an AI module. You probably, Elon Musk is making some product there, which we are not making. It's first time, first choice. But at the end of the day, these things will get, again, you know, will get made by other companies as well, eventually. So it will not have its novelty throughout the time. What you're really doing and what you're really putting across as an entrepreneur, and this is what I personally feel will drive you eventually, get you to the end goal and probably keep you alive over your bad and good times, is that firefighting will always be a part of your life. Take it. I mean, you've bought it, you have signed up for it. Don't complain on it. Don't go for the money. The money is a byproduct. It's not your money. It's your company's money. The investor's money is basically your dream's money. It's not your money. So separate both the identities. Live on your salaries. Saving is not the grace. It's the idea that you're valuing your time. Because often, sir, we kind of talk to people, and I often tell this quote that, you know, we take ourselves too seriously. We are just like one, we are a dot in the entire ocean. And however big or small you are in your bank accounts, it doesn't make any difference. So have the integrity on the product, on your vision, constant, easier said than done. But if you take the money quotient away, I mean, you take the money portion away on the sense of valuations in terms of the money that you've raised, on the bank balances that you have, and you keep working on the product, on the vision, on what you want to do eventually, I think things become much easier, and those entrepreneurs who've done that have done really well for themselves. But like I said, it's odds versus the evens, and the odds always win. I mean, the house always wins. So at the end of the day, you have 10 entrepreneurs stepping in. 8 of them loop out, 2 of them make it, and out of them, 1 becomes a unicorn. So that's how I personally feel. Entrepreneurs lose their way. They should actually just exist in a way where they should just be focused towards their passion and their integrity.
Thank you, Mr. Birla. That was some insightful discussion we had with you, talking about your Cosmic Birla Group as well as the broader entrepreneurship as such. So thank you once again for speaking with the group. There you have it, Mr. Aditya Vikram Birla, Chairman and Managing Director of the Cosmic Birla Group. Good luck to you and to the group as such.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.